Good morning and hey now, PSW staff, clients, and friends joining us. Welcome to Thursday's class. We had a lot of fun on the Sunset Strip yesterday, hanging out in the 60s at the Whiskey A Go-Go and learning about the birth of the go-go dancers and all that stuff. That was cool. Now we're going to go into a different realm. I like to change things up, you know, and we're going to talk about one of my personal favorites, favorite jazz musicians, Oliver Nelson. Oliver Nelson is, if you don't know the name, that's okay. Everybody should know his name. He's very famous. For some reason, he never got the recognition or the clout that Miles Davis or John Coltrane got. And maybe because he didn't live that long, but I'm not really sure why. We'll figure out, but he is one of the most brilliant musicians of the 20th century, and in particular jazz. And for a few reasons, before we get into his life, one of the reasons is that he was so brilliant at, you know, we looked at big bands. There's still big bands today, but we looked at Glenn Miller and Artie Shaw and Tommy Dorsey, big band. Those guys were in the, you know, 40s mostly, right? So Oliver Nelson, he uses that, but he has less musicians, you know, rather than like a 20, 30, 40 piece big band. He uses six or seven guys, and he still somehow maintains that large sound, and that's through his brilliant orchestrating for the instruments. Really hard to do. And Quincy Jones also was able to do that too, but to be able to make a very small group sound large is a really good trick, but also skill and technique. You know, he was kind of writing big band music for a small ensemble, and he liked that. He said that he liked that, probably because of the challenge, and not just because it's challenging because that's good, but also challenging because it has a different sound. We'll hear why it sounds like big band, but it's not a big band. And the other reason why it's important is that his music, and this is really interesting, because usually when you hear that something is difficult and complex, it usually doesn't, you know, sound fun. You know, if somebody said to me, like, I have the most complex movie to tell you, I would, like, tune out probably, right? And then I would say, yeah, that's really difficult and complex. Usually that's not good. His music was really difficult and complex, but it was extremely easy to listen to. So how does he do both? I don't know. We'll have to just figure that out together. So that's why he's important for those reasons. So let's talk about his early life, and then we'll have fun with the very famous album, The Blues and the Abstract Truth. So Oliver Nelson's born into a musical family. Literally everyone played an instrument. He's born in 1932 in St. Louis and starts playing piano at age six, and several years later picks up the saxophone and starts playing in big bands pretty early in life. He joins Louis Jordan's band while he's still playing in his teens. He's playing alto saxophone and arranging their charts. Then he serves in the U.S. Marine Corps in Japan and Korea, playing in the band, and then comes back home to St. Louis and starts studying formal classical composition. Most jazz musicians, you know, a few we've talked about, did get the formal training. Miles Davis was at Juilliard for a little bit. We talked about Nadia Boulanger the other day and how she said, you know, master your art, your technique so well so you can develop your own voice. Don't disregard what's obvious in your path. And so with Oliver Nelson, he decides he needs to, or wants to, learn classical music. And he studies classical composition in 1954 at the Washington University in St. Louis, and continues studying there. And his friend Phil Woods, who's a famous saxophone player in his own right, said that Oliver would eat lunch in his car during these school days because of the segregation and all of that kind of terrible stuff that was going on. And the irony is that he was asked later to guest lecture there. So when he moves to New York in 1959, he starts meeting musicians that are people that we've talked about. And he really starts beginning to do his most famous album, people that non-jazz listeners would buy, Blues in the Abstract Truth. This album comes out in 1961, and this is a gateway jazz album, and I mean that in a way that it got people that weren't interested particularly in jazz. It caught their ear, in particular with Stolen Moments, which is the song we're listening to now and the song that opened up the class. So this album has some of the best players going on at that time. And this is kind of the hard bop era, right? So we had bebop, and then in the 40s and 50s, late 50s, early 60s with Coltrane and Miles, we get modal jazz and kind of hard bop with Lee Morgan as well. But he gets Freddie Hubbard on trumpet, who was a lot kind of like Lee Morgan in a way that we'll talk about in another class. He has Eric Dolphy, who we did a class on. He has George Barrow on baritone saxophone. He has Bill Evans on piano, who's we talked about on the Kind of Blue album. Paul Chambers on bass, who's on the Kind of Blue album, and Roy Haynes on drums. So I've said it a few times, Oliver Nelson really takes, he's very influenced by Miles Davis' Kind of Blue, which came out 2 years before this album. It doesn't sound like it, but the more I think about it, I can see why some people might think that. It is minimal, and in the sense that there aren't several jazz chord changes going on. It doesn't sound like it's busy music in a sense. Also, what's interesting is that all of the compositions on the album follow some sort of 12-bar blues form. And even though each song sounds completely different than the next, my favorite is Hoedown from the album. He's literally kind of doing the rodeo that we talked about from Aaron Copland, and that was, you know, Richard Rodgers influenced by. He's kind of doing this in a jazz way. I mean, where would you ever hear music like this? Harmonically, here's what's interesting about it. Okay, so if you have and we won't get too technical, but if you have a chord, a C chord, a C triad, C, E, G, right? His harmony is quarto harmony. So quarter is four, right? Quarter is a fourth of a dollar. Quartet is four players. So quarto is a type of harmony so C to F is a fourth. The interval is a fourth. His harmony instead of using thirds, which is usually very common in big bands, especially Glenn Miller and Tommy Dorsey and all those, instead of using thirds, he's using fourths, and they sound like this. They sound a little bit, do you hear how it sounds a little bit different? It's not dissonant, but there's something a little bit modern or different sounding. So he's kind of one of the first, one of the first, for sure, jazz big band writers writing in a modern way, if that makes sense, in a way that's using chordal harmony instead of always resolving the fourth to the third, the F to the E in the case of C major. So that's Blues in the Abstract Truth, one of the most famous jazz albums, probably just as famous as Kind of Blue, or just as iconic and powerful and meaningful. He moves to Los Angeles in the late 60s, and in 1967 he goes to LA, and he starts getting a lot of work in film and TV, and scoring and arranging for film and TV, and unfortunately dies from a massive heart attack at 43 in 1975. But I believe his son is still carrying on his legacy, playing his music. Genius composer, arranger, you know, conductor, saxophonist, visionary, real visionary. And in the sense that it was still easy to listen to, right? Like we talked about at the beginning, it was still melodic music, but it had a complexity to it that you didn't notice. But somebody on the radio would be like, hey, turn that up. That's a cool song. This is what, you know, this song grooves. That's, I think, what's so important about Oliver Nelson's music. So hope you enjoyed it. Love that guy. Yeah, what a talent. And tomorrow we have the results for the film scoring challenge for Melancholia. So that will be exciting. Okay, miss you guys. Love you guys. See you tomorrow.